There isn't a more recognized car in the world than the Barris Batmobile. The television series that it starred in was filmed in the middle of the car craze 1960s, and its long fins, bubble top, and screen presence made it a scene stealer, even when it was just parked. Hi, I'm Joe Kelly Jr. This is Playing with Cars. Now, the license to manufacture the Barris Batmobile has been among the most coveted in the hobby for many, many years. Now, Mattel's Elite Division is getting ready to release an upscale version of the model as a companion to the standard release that's already out on the market. To the Batpoles. Customizer with a K, George Barris, had 3 weeks to come up with a car for a new superhero series that would be filming at 20th Century Fox for ABC Television. The show would be a send-up of the Batman comics, starring Adam West as the Batman and Burt Ward as his trusty sidekick, Robin. Now, Batman was different than the other superheroes. Rather than using superpowers, he fought villainy with technology, and so gadgetry was a major part of the script from the jump. So they would need a car that could transport the Caped Crusader while handling all of the crazy doodads that the writers could throw at. Now, Barris would need superpowers to make this deadline. His reputation as something of a genius had been built on an ability to perform cinematic magic on cars. Whether the script called for futuristic design, a hot rod, or just a well-engineered effect that could be triggered on cue. In the Batmobile, the studio got the best of both worlds. A machine that not only looked the part, but could act it as well. Based on the 1955 Lincoln Futura show car, a styling exercise that had starred in its own movie before it was sold to Barris in 1959, the Batmobile took the concept into the realm of fantasy while maintaining its drivability. The moment the car appeared on the show, ABC was overwhelmed with fan mail. Seems like they had a new star on their hands. That success made the car so popular that anyone who made a model of it pretty much guaranteed themselves money in the bank. Now, Mattel has plans for the car in three distinct levels of trim and at three distinct price points. There's the already-in-release standard version with opening doors and steerable wheels, this elite version with an enhanced level of detail and features, and the as-yet-unseen super elite that remains shrouded in a veil of mystery. Of the three, common sense would dictate that this elite one will be the hot ticket. At a price point of between $70 and $80, considering the overall excellence of the model, as well as the nice level of detail and finesse that Mattel's built in, the potential full run of almost 17,000 models should have no problem finding homes. This mid-level version gets opening doors, hood, and trunk, as well as steerable, poseable wheels. It also gets a higher level of detailing, with various and sundry labels affixed to the car where needed, a nice touch that recalls the kitschy approach the producers used to tell the audience what to expect next. There are added on details that are of a higher quality than the ones offered on the budget release. This photo-etched bat detector, the real metal screening at the car's nose and rear panel, and even the photo-etched door handle seem to justify the extra cost. The paint on this exceptionally well-realized body is gorgeous, and the red-orange striping that defines the car's shape is tampoed on. So is the bat symbol on the doors. The chrome seems better, too. The distinctive Raider wheels with their bat centers and the rocket launchers on the rear deck are flashed with a darker, deeper metallic finish than on the lesser model. Between the two halves of the car's futuristic bubble top, the Elite offers up a few nicely tweaked details. Some, like the bat phone and the fire extinguisher bottle, are more intricate castings with added pieces. The floor's been carpeted and the doors are decorated with hard chrome and knobs instead of simple silver paint. The seats get red piping and added safety belts, and above it all, the arch that Barris installed between the Futura's canopy halves is detailed with labels and handles, as well as additional lensing on those indicator lights. The dash is chrome and open to show some of the additional electronics that kept Robin so busy between crime scenes. And up top, the casting's been bumped up with tampos and labels. Cool stuff. The theme here is more chrome, more detail, and more attention to the little things. And it works. One of the things I really truly love about this model is the engine they've dreamed up and installed. It's a jet turbine done with a few sharp chrome castings that have been detailed with basic plumbing, just enough to make the model all the more exclusive. Now I'm happy that Mattel decided on the fanciful rather than the factual here. Seeing a basically stock Lincoln 460 under the hood would have taken away some of the magic. I love the way the engine's lower section dips below the model's front, too. It's a pretty cool sight. I can almost hear that whine as the car pulls up. Out behind the rocket launchers is this lift-up panel. Not so much a trunk as it is a place for the mobile crime computer. It's basically a casting with a couple of stickers, but it represents this occasionally used prop fairly well, as far as I can remember. Car guys have pondered the Batmobile's drivetrain for as long as I can remember, and Mattel's version answers some serious questions, like where did those flames come from? Well, in an exhaust setup that echoes that of the real-life Chrysler turbine car, two giant ducts travel back along the frame, join, and exit through the classic Batmobile jet exhaust rear. It's a single casting, even the drive shaft is cast in, but that doesn't bother me, seeing as how the top side is done so well. In a nutshell, I like this model a lot. Is it absolutely correct? Well, that depends on how much of a Batmobile fan you are. This model represents the car as it exists today, so a few detail pieces might not match up with those archived episodes you know you watch. I don't have any problem recommending this model very, very highly. In fact, being able to compare it side by side with the standard version only cemented the model's value. And if there's any problem I can see is that it's going to make a lot of people want the Super Elite all the more. Well, that's it for this episode of Playing with Cars. I want to thank Brian and Mark from Replicars for getting these models to us for review. We really appreciate it, guys. For the Car Room Magazine, I'm Joe Kelly Jr. Thanks for coming down to the Car Room, and thank you for playing with cars. Take care. Bye-bye.
Okay, Dad.